When the gender industry comes in, whether that's a social media influencer, whether that's a teacher in school, the school counselor, the pediatrician, I count all of those as gender industry workers. When one of them says to a child, this is what's wrong, you're transgender, you need to have hormones, there, you know, sex reassignment surgery, and then you'll feel better. That's a very linear, black and white, right, easy to understand progression. And kids get sucked into it. The entire meeting was about sex and gender, how to get it into the theater, how to get it into schools. And the trainer told the teachers in that meeting, look in the hallway, stand in the hallways at school, look at for the kids who are alone at their lockers. Those kids, you can go and talk to them about sex and gender. Go to the lunchroom, see the kids who are sitting by themselves. You can go talk to them about sex and gender. Dr. Morse, that's predatory behavior. That is predatory grooming behavior. Mm-hmm. Find the kids who are by themselves and go approach them. There is a counselor, a school counselor in California who is caught on tape teaching other parents and counselors how to start GSA clubs. And she said, it's no secret, we poach kids from the counseling department. They know very well that they're going after the vulnerable kids.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, an interfaith international coalition to defend the family. Marriage, family, human sexuality, all these issues are in a state of confusion and chaos. At the Ruth Institute, we bring you solid scientific information to help you make sense of a world that's lost its mind. So welcome back to reality. My guest today is Maria Keffler, co-founder of Partners for Ethical Care, an international organization that seeks to halt the unethical medicalization of children for profit. You can read about her accomplishments in the show notes below. And as you're getting settled into our world of common sense and sound thinking, be sure to hit the subscribe button below and hit that little bell to get notifications of our latest uploads. And do keep your finger on that share button because you're going to want to share this video with your friends and family. Welcome to the Dr. J Show, and welcome back to reality. Maria Keffler, thank you so much for being my guest on the show today.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me, Dr. Morse. I'm really glad to be here.
Yes, I've been following you partly on Facebook and the Compassion Coalition, partly on your site, the Partners for Ethical Care, and your friend, Erin Brewer, who is your co-founder of the Partners for Ethical Care. She has already been a guest on our show, actually a couple of times. So tell people a little bit about the organization, Partners for Ethical Care. What kind of organization are you and what's your mission?
Okay. Yeah, Partners for Ethical Care launched just very recently, actually, in November of 2020. We have a good-sized team of people who we had all been working on this issue of pushing back against the gender industry in various places. I originally came from Arlington Parent Coalition in Arlington, Virginia, which is my school district, and we had a small group of a team that's been working as a watchdog group on the district level. And of course, Erin Brewer has been working on pushing back on the therapy bans, and some of our other team members have been working, pushing back in terms of pornography and sex trafficking, and we have several parents who have kids who are suffering from gender confusion. So we pulled this team together of this people who've been working in all different places and said, we need to kind of come together. We need to make one organization, and we really need to pool our resources, pool our skills, and start pushing back on this in a larger way. And so that's where we came from. And we chose to focus on the medicalization of children because we think that's really the most pressing and horrific thing that's going on that the gender industry is doing, is telling kids, oh, anything that you're uncomfortable about, anything that brings you any sort of discomfort is because you're transgender. And the only way to fix that is to alter your body. And that's just abusive. That's just abusive and deceptive. And it's pure profiteering. And we're horrified at what's happening to this generation of kids, and we want to do whatever we can to make it stop.
So it's a pretty broad coalition of people in terms of their background and their skills and talents and so on and so forth. Tell us a little bit about your background and how you got interested in these issues.
Well, I was a teacher by training. Oh. I have my background as an educational psychology and an English education. I have three kids. They're all now teenagers. And I always was a proponent of the public school. And then a couple of years ago, this was in February of 2019, a friend of mine called me, also in my school district, and said, Maria, I was looking around on the school website for some information about summer school, and I came across this transgender student policy meeting tonight. It's a working group meeting. Will you go with me? I feel strongly like we need to go to this. So I went with her, and we were just awestruck in a horrific way at what we heard. These students, parents, educators were sitting around a table talking about what they wanted to see in the transgender student policy that the school was creating. The school did not let anybody know that this was happening. A later Freedom of Information Act request revealed that the local gender identity special interest group had been working with our school district for nearly a year, completely incognito. Nobody knew what was happening.
Wow.
So we're at this meeting, and our big takeaway from the evening was that the school considers parents to be a threat if they don't affirm sexual orientation and gender identity from the school's perspective. If the parents don't come along with that, the parents need to be cut out of the equation. And we were just horrified to see this, and we would not have known this was happening except my friend was browsing the website looking for summer school information.
Wow.
So a few of us parents got together. We started trying to engage the school, engage the school board, and it quickly became very obvious that we were not welcome. We asked to be included in the next meeting. We were not only not informed, we found out later that there was a meeting and they just didn't bother to call anybody except the special interest group. So that's the genesis of me getting involved in this, is just being horrified at what the school is doing. I've since pulled all three of my kids. I'm homeschooling all three of them now because I no longer consider the public school a safe place for a child.
Oh, wow. Wow. That's quite a testimony that you were deeply committed to public education and you come to the conclusion that it's really not a safe place for your kids. You know, one of the things that the refrain that I've heard numerous times all across the issues relating to the sexual revolution is how the arrogance of the public officials, you know, that they think they know best and, you know, we're going to make the policy and you either go along to get along or, you know, we don't care. We don't care what you think.
Yeah, in our district, the head of the family life education, no, I'm sorry, I'm mistaken. The head of counseling for the district in our district at that first meeting that I went to, she said the school needs to help parents along. I think that was her actual words, was help parents along. If they're not quite on board with sexual orientation and transgender ideology, alternate styles, the school needs to help them along until they understand it better. And I thought that was one of the most arrogant things I'd ever heard an educator say.
Yes. And you, my friend, our mutual friend, Kathy Cleaver Ruse, was on my show about a year ago talking about Fairfax County. I think you're talking about Arlington County, aren't you?
Yeah, Arlington, neighbor okay. Fairfax. Arlington's a little county. Fairfax is enormous. Yeah.
That's right. And Kathy was telling me, you know, a very similar kind of story about how the school board, that at that point it was the whole school board, and how they treated the parents and the public, you know, just the general public. So this is something, you know, when people think, I see now that many people, in the light of the events of the last 18 months or 2 years, a lot of people are like, you know, gosh, this doesn't seem like the land of the free. What's going on? Well, those of us who have been in this area for a long time have known, you know, that there are out of control public officials doing what they can get away with. You have written a very interesting and provocatively titled book that I really want to talk about. It has just come out recently as of the date that we're doing this interview. I think it's been out about 3 weeks. The book is called Desist, Detrans, and Detox, Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult. Tell us about the title of this book, Maria, because the title itself is quite provocative.
It can be, and I did think long and hard about whether to include the word cult in the title. Partners for Ethical Care published the book, and so they were integral in reading it and thinking about what we wanted to put in it. And we all felt like it was the right thing to do to put cult in there, because as I've looked into how the gender industry works, I discovered there is a one-to-one correlation, which I present in the book, between what cults do to recruit and retain members and what the gender industry is doing to kids. It's just a one-to-one parallel. And so it really is a cult. They recruit people. They teach them an ideology. It's very much a religion. Transgender is a religion because there's no science backing it up, even though the gender industry will say there is. When you dig into some of the research studies that they cite, they're very poorly done. The research methodology is awful.
We call it junk science at the Ruth Institute, yeah, because we've been dealing with junk science from the beginning of our organization, you know, and this is just another incarnation of that same thing. You know, there's an idea we want to promote, and we'll invent the science to go along with it. So let's go back to one of the basic tenets of the cult. I want to come back to cult, but I want to go to the core word of gender, because you say something very interesting and I think quite important about the word gender. There's a difference between sex and gender. And I've covered this in other interviews with other people, but for people who are coming to the Ruth Institute for the first time, I want you to spell out what is meant by the word sex, what is meant by the word gender in this context.
Well, there are the accurate definitions of those words, and then there are the definitions that the gender industry uses. Accurate definitions, the definition of sex is your biology. Humans are a sexually dimorphic species. We have two sexes, female and male, women and men. That is what sex is. Gender, until the 1960s, referred to linguistics. Some languages, like the Romance languages, nouns have gender, feminine or masculine, and that their grammar is affected by that, whether you use masculine or feminine determiners, masculine or feminine adjectives. And it was completely a linguistic term. But in the 1960s, John Money, who was a self-described sexologist, co-opted that term and applied it to people. Gender has no meaning for people. Historically, we use gender and sex kind of interchangeably. I wish now that we hadn't. The gender industry is saying that, yes, sex is maybe your category based on your chromosomes, but gender is the sex that you are inside. It's the sex of your spirit. It's the sex of your brain. It's this amorphous sense of self. That's your gender. And really what they're talking about is personality, because everything that the gender industry talks about when they're talking about gender are stereotypes. They're all based on stereotypes. Oh, boys don't like to dance ballet. So if a boy likes to dance ballet, he must really be a girl inside. Therefore, we need to medicalize him. Mm-hmm. Oh, girls don't like to dig in the dirt and play with trucks. If a little girl does that, it means that her internal self is really a boy. It's utterly ridiculous. And it really hobbles people, hobbles kids in terms of it just being who they are. Let's just let kids be who they are and celebrate who they are and not tell them they need to be medicalized.
But of course, that phrase, be who you are, is used to push people towards transitioning, because they're trying to say your real identity is somehow determined by these stereotypes. I've always heard it described as that that gender refers to the parts that are social and social expression and socially constructed, all important, socially constructed, and whereas sex is biology, as you said, and that it has to do with the body. But if sex is socially, if gender rather is socially constructed, well, then by golly, it can be reconstructed. And that seems to be what we're about here, is reconstructing. And now we're reconstructing. Early on, people were trying to reconstruct society so that men and women could live up to some kind of feminist ideal. And now they're trying to reconstruct society and the body so it can live up to some, I don't know what, some gender ideological view of how things are. Let me ask you, you continually use this phrase, the gender industry. Yeah. And I don't hear people use that term very much. Generally, I hear people talk about the gender ideology. I often use that terminology. Tell us what you mean when you use the term gender industry.
Well, at Partners for Ethical Care, we use the term gender industry because this is a money-making organization. Mm-hmm. This is a group of people and corporations and systems that are embracing gender ideology because it's a moneymaker. A child who becomes medicalized, a child who takes puberty blockers, and we know studies have shown once a child goes on puberty blockers, almost 100% of them go on to cross-sex hormones. There is a lot of money in that. Mm-hmm. People who have detransitioned, which means that they lived a transgender identified lifestyle for a while, probably on some of these hormones and medications, and then they changed their mind and said, I want to live as my birth sex. They talk about the thousands, tens, hundreds of thousands of dollars they spent, their insurance company spent on these medications, on these surgeries. A couple of months.
Their insurance company, and probably in some cases, government insurance. Mm-hmm. Doesn't Medicare, Medicaid, those type of government programs also pay for this kind of stuff? Yeah, which is how a child can end up having this happen without mm-hmm. their parents or their parents' insurance being involved. Is that right?
In some places, parents are cut out of it entirely. In the state of Oregon, once a child turns 13, that child is responsible for his or her own health care decisions, and the parent is cut out of the equation at 13.
Very interesting.
Kids who are 13, boys who are 13 are still playing with Beyblades and Hot Wheels cars, some of them are. Right. Girls at 13, half of them haven't even had their periods yet, and yet that state is saying that parents need to be cut out of the equation. The reason parents are cut out of the equation is because parents are their children's best protectors. Parents are the ones who are going to say, no, I don't think cutting off your breasts at 14 is a good idea. Parents have a long view of things. We know neurology teaches us our brains don't finish developing till we're in our mid-20s. The last part of the brain to develop is the frontal cortex. That is the part of the brain that deals with long-term consequences, long-range planning, risk-taking behaviors. That's why teenagers do so many risky things, because their risk-taking part of their brain hasn't finished developing yet. They need their parents to say, no, this is not a good idea. I'm not going to let you go down this road. And the gender industry, which are all the people who are making money off of children who have transgender identification, they don't want parents involved. This is very, very much like predators, child predators. Child predators, sexual predators have a very specific way they go about grooming a child. And one of the things that they do is get the parents to trust them, appear a trustworthy friend to the parents, and then separate the child from the parents. So it's just the child and the predator. And that's exactly what we see happening here. Exactly.
Yes. Before we go down that path further, because I definitely want to go down that path, I want to just go back to this question of the parents being cut out of medical decisions. Because Maria, I can remember, my daughter is now 28. And I can remember when she was, I want to say around 12 or 13, at some point in her, you know, her right around the time of puberty age, my doctor informed me that she was required by law to allow my daughter to be in the room with her alone without me there. Okay. So this way predates transgenderism or anything like that. And what they were looking for is family abuse and and reproductive rights. This is how teens were going to exercise their constitutional reproductive rights without their parents knowing, is for there to be the parents, the medical establishment being between the parents and the child. And at that time, you know, the thing they were talking about at that time that I remember very, very clearly, because that was an issue, was Gardasil, which was this vaccine that supposedly protected teen girls from sexually transmitted diseases. And they were basically selling the kids on getting that vaccine without their parents in the room. So people are worried about vaccines, people who are worried about medicalization of children. This has been going on a long time. Okay, this whole process of separating the kids from their parents, you know, that's at least 15 years old, Maria. Oh, yeah. You know, I have to say at least that.
Well, so if you look at comprehensive sex ed, which is the sex education program that's coming out of SIECUS, the SIECUS, the Sex Information and Education something.
Council of America.
Thank you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. SIECUS, their comprehensive sex ed, it's a huge guide. It's 50 some pages, covers sex ed from kindergarten through 12. When you read through that, if you take note of every time they say without parental knowledge, it's frightening. Mm-hmm. They're providing kids, here's how you get an abortion without parental knowledge. Here's how you get birth control pills without parental knowledge, over and over and mm-hmm. over again. Mm-hmm. And all parents need to be standing up and saying no.
Yes. And that's the thing. The trans cult, a lot of times people ask me, oh, Dr. Morris, where did this trans thing come? It seemed like it came out of nowhere. You know, no, it did not come out of nowhere. The groundwork has been there for a long time, you know, and this train has been moving along. And a lot of the people who are now working with us on the trying to stop the medicalization of children, some of them may have been on earlier stages of that train, you know, and thought it was okay. And, you know, I want to say to those people, you know, I hope that you're willing to rethink some of your prior commitments, maybe. But even if you're not, let's get this done, because we got to put a stop to it right here and now. So let's talk now about the cult aspects of this, because I think that's one of the very interesting things that you have to say in your book, Desist, Detrans, and Detox, getting your child out of the gender cult. Tell people what you mean. What's the cult-like behavior that you see at work here?
The whole industry, the whole process is very cult-like in that it starts, I call GSA clubs, Gender and Sexuality Allies clubs, which are clubs for LGBTQ kids in schools. I believe those are recruitment centers because that's what I see happening. Kids who have come out of it have said, I was pulled into it at the GSA club. One of the things that cults do, they identify a target. They identify somebody that they want in the cult and they love bomb them. They bring them in, we're going to have this great get together. We're going to have food. We're going to have entertainment. The recruit comes and they are just surrounded with love and affirmation. We're so glad you're here. You're so great. This is amazing. We have this human need for affirmation. We have this human need to feel loved and cared for. And you've got this population of kids. And I would say this is almost all kids, middle and high school, anybody who remembers middle or high school, most of us don't remember that as just a great time that everything went beautifully and we had wonderful things to say about it. We all struggled. We all struggled socially. We all struggled emotionally. You've got this group now, the GSA club, that when you come into that group, you are practically in a gang. That is a group of people who they will tell you that you're wonderful. They'll tell you that everything you think is fantastic. Once you say that you are transgender, you think you're transgender, nobody can question you. Mm-hmm. Nobody can criticize you. These kids get teachers fired. If the teacher uses the name or the pronoun they don't like, they get the teacher fired. So there's a very gang aspect to that, but it's also the love bombing. Kids just soak that up. Love me. Tell me I'm great. I need somebody to tell me that. And that's what cults do.
Yes. And, you know, that's one of the most disturbing parts of your book, really, honestly, is how vulnerable the kids are and how they target the vulnerable kids. Please tell people about that, because I find it shocking. I mean, honestly, it's so predatory. There's some dreadful statistic about the number of kids the percentage of kids who are on the autism spectrum?
Autism is huge.
Tell us about it. Tell everybody about it.
Studies are showing that up to 65-70% of kids who are identifying as transgender, and I'm talking now about kids, middle school, high school, early college age kids, 60-70% of them are presenting either with a diagnosis of autism, or they're showing behaviors that indicate that they may have a diagnosis that they haven't received yet of autism. Lisa Littman did a landmark study in 2018 out of Brown University. She found, had 256 subjects, and I believe it was 62% of them either had already been diagnosed with autism, or they presented with behaviors and things that indicated that they probably are on the autism spectrum. That's huge. Why aren't we talking about that? Why was Lisa Littman's study attacked as soon as it came out? It was attacked, and Brown University took it down until they could reevaluate it. They found one small little thing that they needed to tweak and as far as how she reported something, but they put it back up and said, this is a robust and reliable study. But when parents have a child who's on the spectrum, and then that child says, hey, I think I'm transgender. If the parent says, hey, I think this has to do with autism, they're immediately labeled unsupportive. Mm-hmm. The school will not discuss autism. The mm-hmm. therapist will not discuss autism. The pediatrician will not discuss autism. Why is that? In every other area of a child who is on the autism spectrum, every other area of their life, everyone's asking, is this problem related to autism?
Right.
Is this
right.
gift related to autism? But when it comes to transgender ideology, we're not allowed to discuss that.
In what way, Maria, in your observation, and perhaps Dr. Littman has something to say about this as well, in what way do you think that it is related, autism and transgenderism?
Autism presents with a lot of struggles that relate to social functioning and mm-hmm. sensory issues and also verbal issues. Those are kind of the three big things, social, verbal, and sensory issues. And not every autistic child exhibits all of them. It's called a constellation disorder because different people have different issues with that. But they tend to have sensory issues. So they're uncomfortable with the tag in their shirt. They're uncomfortable with the way their clothes feel. And think about what happens to a child when they enter puberty. Everything about their body is changing. They're growing parts they didn't have before. Things are getting larger. Things are getting smaller. Things are changing. For someone on the autism spectrum who's already uncomfortable with his or her body, that can feel like a cataclysm. And along comes the transgender ideology people who say, oh, the reason you feel so uncomfortable is because you're transgender. No, no, no. The reason they feel uncomfortable is because they're on the autism spectrum and they need to be told that this is normal and it will
right.
pass. And
they right, will feel right, better. Right, right, right. That they will feel better, that it will pass. And they need, and a lot of times with an autistic child, you need to be very concrete and very specific about, you know, you're going to feel better if you do this, this, and this.
Yeah.
Just wait, just be patient, it'll be okay. But what the trans industry or the gender industry says to them is the specific things you need are changes to your hormones, changes to your body. That's going to make everything okay. And in their minds, that works.
Yeah, because autistic people, one of their other features is they tend to have very black and white thinking.
That's right. Yeah.
All this, all that. And so when the gender industry comes in, whether that's a social media influencer, whether that's a teacher in school, the school counselor, the pediatrician, I count all of those as gender industry workers. When one of them says to a child, this is what's wrong, you're transgender, you need to have hormones, sex reassignment surgery, and then you'll feel better. That's a very linear, black and white,
right.
easy to understand progression. And kids get sucked into it because it seems logical. It
right.
seems reasonable.
Right.
But it's
if
not.
You accept the opening premise, mm-hmm. then it will follow logically.
Yeah.
And that opening premise is in some ways easier to accept than the idea that normal people have 5 years of sheer misery, and that's normal.
Yeah.
That's, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we all go through that.
Yeah,
and
that's
autistic,
right.
Yeah, autistic kids also struggle with social issues.
Yes.
They think their brains work differently than most
Which
other
they
people.
Do. Which they do. Their brains do work differently.
Yeah. And
so then they go in, then they go into the club and they get love bombed.
Yeah. Yeah, they feel uncomfortable. They don't feel like they have a friend group. They feel a little weird. They recognize that. I mean, we all kind of probably felt that way when we were that age. Mm-hmm. But people on the autism spectrum, they recognize something is different about them. And yeah, they go to the GSA club and they get love bombed. And they get told, oh, the reason you feel that way is because you're transgender, but we love you anyway, or we love you for that. We love you being transgender.
Right.
And so they're told, this is the answer. This is why you don't have any friends. It's because you're with the wrong people. You need to be with the transgender people.
Right.
Just a really heinous lie is sold to these poor kids. And too many of them are finding out after they've had the puberty blockers, which has demineralized their bones and slowed their brain development and stopped their body from becoming an adult body. And then they take the cross-sex hormones, and the girls, their voice is lower, which will never change. They get the facial hair, which will never change, probably. They get the balding. The boys take estrogen and develop breasts, which even if they stop taking the estrogen, those don't tend to go away. These kids find out at the end of all this, that didn't help.
Yeah.
That didn't help. You said it would help. Why didn't it help? And then the doctors, the therapists who push this affirmation only plan, they don't have anything to offer. They don't want to talk to those kids anymore because that suggests that they did something wrong. And these poor kids are just dropped on their own with no help or support at all. It's really hideous what's happening to these kids.
Including shockingly enough, from the insurance companies. Because the medical insurance companies at one time were kind of dragging their feet about this because, you know, it costs them a lot of money. You would think they would be monitoring what's going on because they're paying out the money. But for whatever reason that took place, they aren't monitoring that. And so they pay for the assignment surgery, but it's my understanding that most of them don't pay for the detransitioning. Is that true?
Yeah.
That's considered cosmetic and not.
Yeah. Well, not, and this is one of the hypocrisies. There's so many hypocrisies of the gender industry. But let's say I'm a woman with large breasts and it's giving me back pain. It's giving me problems. Or I'm just uncomfortable with my body. My insurance company is not going to pay for me to have a breast reduction. But if I'm a girl who said, you know what, I really think I'm a boy, I want to have my breasts removed, oh, insurance companies will pay for that.
Right.
But then when that same girl says, you know what, I decided I'm not transgender. I realized my functional breasts are gone, but I want to have reconstructive surgery to look like a woman again. Well, too bad. That's on your own dime. The insurance companies won't cover that.
It's shocking. And the thing that surprises me about it, or the thing I want to emphasize about it, as a social scientist, as an economist in social science, no one can conceivably claim that this whole sequence of events is organic or natural or a grassroots movement. This is a top-down thing all the way.
Well, and it has also been sort of falsely created as a bottom-up thing via social media influencers.
That's right. That's
because
right.
Because they're, you know, your kids go onto TikTok, onto Instagram. I just want to say for everybody, I have become a believer in no social media for teenagers. Like, just shouldn't have it, because this is on every social media platform. Influencers are people who are paid to influence people on social media. And you've seen beauty influencers like the Kardashians who sell makeup or jewelry or clothes or whatever. There is an army of social media influencers who are there to convince kids they are transgender. It's on every platform.
Who is paying them? Maria, who's paying these people? Do you know?
There's a lot of money in it. Jennifer Billick has done a lot of work looking into the technology and looking into the roots of it. And I don't want to claim that I know anything about that, because I don't. But I know organizations like the Human Rights Campaign, GLSEN, Gay, Lesbian, Straight Education Network, these are all LGBTQ organizations. They have a lot of money pouring into groups like, well, in Fairfax County, the Equality Fairfax, I think they call themselves, it's LGBTQ group out there. Money was coming in for them to put on programs in schools,
right?
Books in libraries. Mm-hmm. And again, I want people to understand the pharmaceutical companies and the cosmetic surgeons are the ones who are making money off of this. Mm-hmm. And it is horrific what we are doing to our children. I have seen so many pictures of a young girl with her breasts cut off and a cosmetic surgeon there smiling.
I know, it's smarmy, ghoulish.
Thumbs up. It is ghoulish. That is a fantastic.
Yeah, it's ghoulish. So I'd like you to describe a few more of the vulnerable parties, the vulnerable kinds of kids that are targeted by this whole thing. Yeah, so the autistic kids, that's huge, but there are some other groups that you mention in your book. Tell people about that.
Kids who have prior trauma, and our friend Erin Brewer is a perfect example of this. She was traumatized by a sexual assault when she was only 6 years old. And shortly after that, she decided that she was a boy. So kids who have, it doesn't just have to be sexual trauma, but any sort of trauma in their past, it can be a family divorce, death of a loved one, death of a sibling, loss of some important relationship, any kind of trauma can feed into this. And I think one of the reasons for that with trauma is one unhealthy coping mechanism with trauma is dissociation. Mm-hmm. You dissociate from your body. Your mind kind of exits your body almost. People who dissociate have talked about they feel like they're outside themselves watching what's happening. And this ideology, transgender, saying that, oh, your inside can be different than your outside, that just settles seamlessly on top of dissociation disorder.
Yes. You know, Walt Heyer, who's one of the pioneers in this area, he talks about exactly that he was abused as a child and he lived as a woman for years and came back and so on and so forth. I think he must be in his 80s by now, but Walt has been a great voice for the detransition trans regret movement. But he specifically says, you know, doggone it, I figured out after the fact that I had a personality dissociative disorder. That's what I was really trying to treat. Nobody talked about treating that, even way back in the day when he was dealing with it, you know. Yeah. And so that's a part of it. So how do they find these kids? How do they target these kids whose parents have been through a divorce or whatever? And you know, you're making the claim. This is an audacious claim you're making, that people who've been traumatized, young people who've been traumatized, are being targeted. How are they getting that done?
Social media is huge. Partners for Ethical Care did an informal survey of detransitioners, and the largest segment of them said they were originally introduced to trans ideology via social media, via these influencers on social media. School is also a huge proponent of this. I talked to a parent in Washington, D.C. a couple of months ago who went to a meeting for theater teachers. It was local community theater producers and also elementary, I think there was even middle school teachers there doing theater programs. It was a diversity, equity, inclusion training, which, you know, you think that's going to mean one thing and it means something else. She said the entire meeting was about sex and gender, how to get it into the theater, how to get it into schools. And the trainer told the teachers in that meeting, look in the hallway, stand in the hallways at school, look at for the kids who are alone at their lockers. Those kids, you can go and talk to them about sex and gender. Go to the lunchroom, see the kids who are sitting by themselves. You can go talk to them about sex and gender. Dr. Morse, that's predatory behavior. That is predatory grooming behavior. Mm-hmm. Find the kids who are by themselves and go approach them. There is a school counselor in California who was caught on tape teaching other parents and counselors how to start GSA clubs. And she said, it's no secret we poach kids from the counseling department. They know very well that they're going after the vulnerable kids.
Wow. You know what this reminds me of? This reminds me of the stories that one hears about clergy sex abuse, because this is another area that we deal with. That the predator, the clergy sexual predator knows which kid just lost his father or mm-hmm. knows what child has gone to counseling. And that's who they prey on. It's horrible. And I think I'm bringing this up deliberately, everybody, because most people recognize that when a priest preys on a little boy whose father just died, that there's something heinous has just happened there. And what I want you to do is to take that outrage and apply it to this situation. One situation's considered politically incorrect. It's perfectly okay to attack a Catholic priest. It's not perfectly okay to attack a trans activist. But the fact is, the behavior is very, very similar. And that's what I want people to wrap their minds around. Just start thinking about that. Tell us more, Maria.
There was an interview in The New Yorker. This was several years ago, and I cited in the book, a social worker or a therapist was working with a sex offender. Jeffrey Clay was his name. And she interviewed him about how he found his kids. He got a job as a teacher in an elementary school. Most teachers are wonderful people who want to help children. But sexual predators want to get around children, and schools are a place that there are a lot of children. So there are sexual predators who try to get into schools to be trusted by the parents, and that's what this man did. He said he would just work through the class. He would start asking boys if they wanted to stay after school. Could they erase the board? Did they want to stay and have a math club or something? He said boys who said, well, let me ask my mom and dad, he screened them out. He would go no further with them because he knew they were being watched.
Wow.
Kids who could stay without having to ask their parents, he knew he could pursue them. That is the importance of parents. That is how important parents are. And we need to claim that authority to protect our kids. We don't let anybody violate that authority.
You know, this just resonates with so many other interviews that I've done. You know, Jeffrey Epstein's victims, some of them reported, you know, he picked girls out of foster care.
Yeah.
You know, their recruiters picked girls out of foster care. Another guy told me who was involved in dealing with sex traffickers. Mm-hmm. They would go up to girls in the mall and tell them they had pretty eyes. Mm-hmm. And if she looked at him and said, oh, thank you, he would go no further. But if she looked at her shoes and didn't know what to say, he knew he had a potential because she was insecure. You know, she was insecure. She'd never heard that before. You know, she's vulnerable. So, wow. That is really so there are a lot of things here for people to be on the lookout for. And this book is really going to help people to know what to be on the lookout for. You know, another interesting thing you talked about here that is cult-like are what you call the thought stoppers. Mm-hmm. The catchphrases that when somebody starts to ask questions or raise questions, the cult teaches you what to say to put that thought out of your mind, you know, so tell people a few of those.
Yeah, that's a classic cult technique it's to preserve the recruit's allegiance to the cult. You know, don't let anybody question your allegiance to the cult. And with the trans cult, some of those thought stopping techniques are trans women or women. I've had that one said to me. I've asked a question. My friend's daughter said this to me. You know, I said, well, now wait, why, is gender fixed or is it fluid? Is it something that can change or is it something that can't change? And she said, trans women or women. Like, that has nothing to do with what I just asked you. That was her way of not having to think about the question.
Right.
To see that. The other one is, you think trans kids shouldn't exist. I got that one said to me by a trans rights activist in my district when I said to him, I said, yeah, I understand that kids who are transgender identified feel more comfortable in the bathroom that they want to go to, but how do we make sure that boys and men who have nefarious intentions don't take advantage of that? And he said, you think trans people shouldn't exist. And I was so taken aback by that, but that's a thought stopping technique. Mm-hmm. That, and it was successful for me that it derailed me from my question. It completely derailed me. I wasn't prepared for it.
Right.
A lot of these dichotomies, false dichotomies, are rampant in the trans ideology. Trans kids just want to use the bathroom. What that suggests and what you'll see in headlines is if trans kids don't get to use the bathroom of their choice, they don't get to use the bathroom at all. No, right. That's not true at all.
Right.
There's a third option, which is they use a single stall bathroom, or they use the bathroom that aligns to their sex.
Or we talk to them about becoming more comfortable in their body instead of taking them down this track. You know, the whole sexual revolution is like this, Maria. I that's why I'm so glad you're bringing this up, because, you know, if you look back to earlier phases of the sexual revolution, you'll see these false dichotomies everywhere. Here's one of my favorite. Oh, you think parents should stay together just for the sake of the kids? What about abusive parents? Isn't it terrible for kids to be living with parents who don't love each other? As if the only two options are continue fighting like crazy or divorce. Wait, there's a third option. You guys could stop quarreling. You know, you could think about that.
Get help. Get some marriage therapy.
Yeah. You know, I mean, it's like, but I think people need to see how much of this is, how manipulative it all is, and how, what's the word I'm looking for? It's propaganda. I think of it as propaganda and mind control. You use this term called identity. What did you call it? I have it written down here. I'd never heard it before. Identity engineering. What do you mean by that? That's really interesting. Identity engineering, because they're giving these kids an identity somehow, right?
Yeah.
But they're controlling it too.
They are. Another facet of cult behavior is that the cult is subjugating a person's true identity and putting onto them the identity the cult wants them to have. Yeah. I mean, if you think about Moonies in the airports in the 70s, they all look the same, right? The flowing robes and the long hair and the flower, and they had certain ways they spoke. Cults have, this is the identity that we want you to have. The gender industry is creating little clones. When I talk to parents who've gone through this, their stories are identical. Mm-hmm. When I talk to a new parent, they just want to unload what's happened, and they want to spend 45 minutes just unburdening themselves. And I listen and I listen, but I'm like, I can just quote the next thing.
Right.
It's exactly the same. Mm-hmm. And so if you look at trans identified girls who want to identify as boys, there's a look. They have the cropped hair, sometimes dyed green or blue. They wear a flannel shirt over a t-shirt, sweatpants. I mean, they just look like clones. And so the industry has created this persona, this way to be. And this just, it reinforces, this is our group.
It's your uniform. It's your uniform in the cult. Yeah. And you can find other people. Mm-hmm. You know, you can sort of intuit that they're on your team and that kind of thing. And it separates you from others. It's yet another technique for separating you from your loved ones. So you have a very interesting chapter here about the rest of the family, called The Rest of the Family. And this is very interesting to me and to us here at the Ruth Institute, because one of the things we've often noticed is that when somebody follows some tenet of the sexual revolution, it's all about them and their feelings and their happiness and their fulfillment and so on and so forth. No one ever pays attention to the people who are left behind or the wreckage left in the wake. Yeah. And to have a family member decide they're not in the right body, you're not born in the right body. You thought you had a father, but really you didn't have a father. You have a woman, you know, it's very disruptive for the other members of the family. It's disruptive to the siblings and everybody. And all those people are expected to shut up. They're expected to go along with the program. So tell people more about, you know, anybody who might be listening here who's in this situation or knows someone in this situation, how can you be supportive of the family members who are being traumatized by this whole situation?
Yeah, it's something that doesn't get a lot of consideration. And Aaron and I do a Commonsense Care series for parents. And a few weeks ago, we did one on siblings of transgender identified kids. And I was doing some research for it. I try to find what are experts saying, what's in the literature, what's out there. There was nothing siblings, except how to get the siblings to support the transgender identified kid. It was all, as you said, it's all about the transgender identified person. And siblings who are dealing with this, they have really unique, special needs that they need to have addressed. If the siblings are younger than the trans-identified child, I will almost guarantee they're being bullied. They're being bullied behind the parents' backs by the trans-identified kid.
Yeah.
Because the trans-identified child wants to be called this, to be treated this way, and the younger siblings are getting bullied. I talked to one mom who his, her son was so frustrated with his little sister. I think the son was about 13, the little sister was about 10, and it was the little sister who was trans-identifying. And the son was just done. He was just done with it. He said, you know, mom and dad, make this stop. Just make it stop. And this poor mom, she's like, I'd make it stop if I could. I wish I could make it stop. But in talking to the mom, I realized this boy had been so proud of his little sister. She used to dance ballet. And he just thought she was so wonderful and so talented, and he loved her. All of a sudden, she has literally tried to kill the person that she was. Yeah. The term dead name gives that away. Mm-hmm. Your dead name is the name your parents gave you. They are trying to kill who they were and change and become somebody different. And he was just heartbroken.
Yeah.
And some siblings are going to be 100% on board with it. And they're going to be ready to cut the parents off just as soon as the parents don't agree. The grandparents, I've talked to people who said, my parents haven't seen their granddaughter in 4 years. It's breaking their hearts.
Yeah.
It is just, this is one of the worst things that can happen to an individual or a family.
Right, right. And the point is with all of these issues that have to do with sex, marriage, family, human sexuality, and the body, mm-hmm. it never happens just to one individual. Mm-hmm. It never is about one individual. It's presented to us like it's about one individual, mm-hmm. but that individual is connected to others, and all of those others are affected, the grandparents, the parents. Mm-hmm. Oh my golly, you know, and so it's almost like, it's individualism on steroids. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like the absolute worst stereotype mm-hmm. of American consumer culture. Mm-hmm. By golly, have it your way. If you got the money to pay for it, you can do whatever you want, and the heck with everybody else. And that's just not real. You know, that's just not real to the human condition whatsoever. Yeah. And the divisions in the family, it's very interesting that you said that, because I too have talked to families, you know, family members where, you know, a sibling, where the family basically pairs up or divides, whether it's around whether the parents are at odds with each other or the parents versus some of the children, and mm-hmm. you know, just the divisions that are created, it's unbelievably painful and
you
tragic.
You just really couldn't design something better to divide and destroy families, to divide yes. and destroy people and families.
Yes.
I mean, this is just a genius Machiavellian way to go after the family.
Yes. Yes.
And I like what you said about individualism. You know, in America, we're very proud of being an individualistic right. society. Other societies tend to be more focused on family and relationships. And it's a little bit of a side story, but some years ago, I was jogging, and there was a lady in our neighborhood park who was clearly homeless, and she'd show up there occasionally. And I stop and talk to her a little bit, but I didn't really think, she was clearly had some mental health issues. But I'd ask her, you know, if there's anything she needs, you know, and she said, no, I'm fine, I'm fine. Well, I was leaving the park one day, and a woman was walking into the park from across the street. She stopped to talk to me. She was not born in America. I don't know where she was from, but she had a very thick accent from possibly a Middle Eastern country. But she pointed to that homeless lady and she asked me, do you know her? And I said, no, I don't know her. I talked to her a little bit, but I don't know her well. This woman asked me, who is taking care of her? Mm-hmm. And I thought, what a question. I never mm-hmm. thought to ask that question. Mm-hmm. As an individualistic American, my thought was, do I need to call the police? Do I need to get her, you know? I didn't think to ask who's taking care of her. And I think that's such an important question we need to ask for everybody in our lives.
Right.
Who's taking care of that child? Who's taking care of that person?
Right, right. And what you've been describing is a system that systematically separates people from those who could take care of them and who want to take care of them and who are best equipped to take care of them. And so it accelerates our individualism. It's like it's feeding on our personality trait that could be an okay personality trait, but it's gone to such extreme and been fed and, you know, until it's now completely toxic, you know, completely over the top toxic. Tell people more about how they can be involved with what you're doing, what resources you might have for families who are going through this type of thing and so on. Just let's get our audience connected to you, girlfriend, because you got some good stuff going on.
Thank you. Please come to partnersforethicalcare.com. That's our website. We have a wealth of resources and information there. We have a page of resources, things for parents. I can't say that I think any child is safe in public school, but I am well aware that not everyone can pull from public school. So we have some resources for how to help keep your child safe in public school, including a universal opt-out letter that tells the school, I don't want to just opt out of sex education and family life education. I want my kid opted out of everything related to sex and gender in school. So we have a form template letter there that can help with that. We have some other guides, resources. Erin's in my Commonsense Care series. We're doing different topics around parenting gender-confused children. We'd love to have you come and look at that. I just really recommend people go to your school district's website and start looking around and start digging. That initial transgender student policy that I told you about, when it was up for discussion, it was three links deep in the website. After they passed it and it became policy, it is now eight links deep. Wow. I know right where it is, and I have a hard time finding
it.
So the school boards are doing this.
Yes. So people can find you and your organization. Let's mention the name of the book one more time, because people should buy the book. I forgot. I was going to ask you about what Amazon did to your book. Amazon took your book down, and then they put it back up. So as of this interview, it's back up. But you're definitely being watched by certain parties.
We've been censored. Let's see.
All the best people are getting censored, girl. It's all good.
Lulu originally published our book. They took us down and deleted our whole account. They said that they're going to pay out our royalties, but I have no way to check because they've deleted our account. Amazon never deleted our account. They just took our book down, but Amazon did put our book back up. It's there digitally and in paperback. Smashwords just deleted us this past week. I'm really disappointed. I thought they were a less of a censorial platform, but they took us down too. You know, the trans rights activists are sending emails to all of the platforms and telling them to take our book down. I'm really proud of Amazon for putting it back up. It is available at our website in PDF form. And so you can download it in PDF form and print it yourself at home. If you're unable to get it another way. I know certain countries, it's not available.
But I would strongly recommend everybody to purchase a physical copy of these books. The books like your book, Detox, Detrans, and Desist. Getting your child out of the gender cult. It's very important that you own physical copies of these books, because oftentimes when Amazon deletes a book or takes a book down, they take it off your Kindle. I've had books taken off my Kindle that Amazon considered bad books. So, you know, I went and found a used copy, and so I now have a physical copy of the book. But you must, in this age of censorship, everybody, you must own physical copies of banned books yourself. That is your way of sticking it to the system, is that you own these books. One other fun thing you guys did is, didn't you sponsor protests out in front of gender clinics? Were you involved in that?
We have ongoing.
Tell people.
Yeah, we have ongoing protests. Our first ones took place, I can't remember the date. I think it
doesn't matter. Late March. You're doing them all over the place.
We've got partners. We just had a protest in Australia a couple weeks ago. So we have partners in various places that are doing those, and we're trying to support them with some marketing materials, some banners, billboards, and things that they can use. Just trying to get the word out, because people do not understand as a whole what's going on. They're being told, oh, this is just letting, as you said, let people be who they are. Let Ellie call herself Elias. You know, what's wrong with that? People don't realize what's happening from a medical perspective. And so we're just trying to get the word out, just trying to get people to see.
people don't realize the medical implications, and they don't understand the propaganda and censorship aspects of it. I mean, they should not be needing to censor people if all it was about was letting people be who they are. They're up to some things that they that will not really withstand the light of day. So it's very important that people continue to talk about it. So Maria Keffler, I'm so glad that you've been my guest today on this edition of the Dr. J Show. I want to let everyone know that Maria Keffler will be a participant in our Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution coming up in Lake Charles in July. So I hope you'll all be involved in that. And if you miss it, if you're watching this a year from when we broadcast it, that's okay, because those videos will be up and available and you'll be able to participate in it that way. And once again, do keep an eye on the share button down below. If this material has been helpful to you, please be thinking of people that you can share it with. Maybe your counselor or a school counselor or a priest or a educator that you know who's frustrated with this type of thing. People need to know that there are others that they can band together with and who share their values. And I do hope that all of you will be involved with Maria Keffler and what she's doing. And stay tuned for further episodes of the Dr. J Show. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse for the Ruth Institute. Thank you so much for watching.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.